Diversity of microorganisms. We are going to look at the different types of microorganisms in this lecture. At the end of this lecture, you should be able to identify features that are common to all types of cells. We are also going to compare and contrast prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. You should be able to classify living things as animals, plants, fungi, protista, and monera. We are going to look at the common microorganisms, and we are going to look at the basics of light microscopy and the use of the light microscope. What is a cell? A cell is a single unit of life. We have trillions of cells in our body. If you were to look at the stomach here, just take a small portion of the stomach and then magnify it, you will see that it has got hundreds and thousands of cells. Each one that you see here is a cell. And these black dots that you see are the nucleus of this cell. There are two broad categories of cell. You have the prokaryotic cell and the eukaryotic cell. An example of a prokaryotic cell will be the bacteria. Bacterial cells are prokaryotes. And examples of eukaryotes will be the animal and plant cells. Here you see a prokaryotic cell and a eukaryotic cell. And here it shows that there are four common features. The plasma membrane, or you can call it the cell membrane, the cytoplasm, the DNA, the genetic material DNA, and the ribosomes. So these are four common features that are found in both the prokaryotic cell and the eukaryotic cell. Now, what are the differences between the prokaryotic cells and the eukaryotic cells? The prokaryotes have no nuclear membrane, whereas the eukaryotes have nuclear membrane. Now, what does that mean? As you can see here, prokaryote, you see that this is the genetic material in the center and it is not surrounded by any membrane. So there is no membrane surrounding the genetic material. So we call this the nucleoid region. As for the eukaryotic cell, okay, you see that this is the DNA, this one is the DNA, okay, and it is surrounded by a nuclear membrane. You see that this is a nuclear membrane here. So this DNA in the eukaryotic cell is surrounded by a nuclear membrane. Therefore, prokaryotes have no nuclear membrane, eukaryotes have nuclear membrane. This is one big difference between a prokaryotic and a eukaryotic cell. Another difference will be that prokaryotic cells are single cells. The bacteria that belong to prokaryotic, that are prokaryotic cells, have only one cell, they are single cells. Whereas eukaryotes can be single cell, okay, for example, yeast and plasmodium, they are single cell. Eukaryotes can also have many cells, that means they are multicellular. Examples would be plants, animals, mushrooms, these are all multicellular eukaryotic cells. So what is microbiology? It is an area of biology which deals or which studies organisms which are too small to be seen with the naked eye. In this module, we'll be looking at the bacteria, fungi, protozoa, and viruses. Now, what is this monera? Okay. Bacteria belong to the kingdom Monera, fungi belong to the kingdom Fungi, protozoa belong to the kingdom Protista, and viruses are not considered a living thing. We will discuss that later. So these are the four microbes that we will be looking at in this lecture. This slide shows you the size comparison between the different types of cells in comparison with a rain droplet. As you can see, fungal spores are much bigger than bacteria. and viruses are the smallest in this comparison. So if you want to look at a prokaryote, you would need a light microscope, whereas if you want to see a virus, you will need an electron microscope. So if they are so small, how do we study them? Light microscope to look at bacteria and protozoa and fungi. So let's look at the light microscope, the parts and functions of the light microscope. So this is the arm. Yeah, this is the arm and this is the base, which is used to for carrying and supporting the microscope during transport, when you're transporting the microscope. Here you have the ocular lens. Okay, the ocular lens magnifies the image. And this is the nose piece or the turret, which houses the objectives. These are the objectives here. The objectives also magnify the image. And then you have the stage where you place your slides. And the condenser here focuses light from the housing, lamp housing, through the specimen. There are two knobs here, the coarse focus knob, which moves the stage up and down to bring it closer to the objective or away from the objective. And then you have the fine focus knob, which is used to get a clear or sharper image. Special points to note when using the microscope. So as I mentioned, the ocular lens magnifies the image. So it has a magnification, usually 10 times magnification. And then there are four objectives, 4 times, 10 times, 40 times and 100 times. These are the objective magnifications. So the final magnification, when you look at an organ specimen, is actually the product of the ocular magnification, the 10 times of the ocular lens, and the objective magnification. So if you are using a 10 times magnification in the ocular lens, and if you're using a 40 times magnification in the objective, so the total final magnification will be 400 times. So here it shows you the actual what you see under the different objectives. So this is 4 times objective. This is how it looks like. Okay, here you have the 10 times. Okay, objective. And this is how it looks like under the 40 times magnification. And this is for the 100 time magnification. Okay, as you can see, as you increase the magnification, the cells become bigger and much more clearer. You're able to see the contents of the cell more clearly. Another special point to note when using the microscope, we each have our own interpupillary distance. That is the distance between our pupils, two pupils. So for some of us, it could be a bit long, a bit wider. Okay. So it's important for us to adjust the ocular lens to get a good view of the image. Microorganisms are tiny organisms, as you know. Okay, and here, once again, bacteria are unicellular. They are prokaryotes. Fungi and protozoa or parasites are unicellular and multicellular organisms. Now, viruses, as I mentioned, they are non-living things. And here we have the prions. Prions are actually infectious proteins. We will not be covering prions in this lecture, but we will be looking at viruses. We have a lot of microorganisms in our body. So microorganisms that are in our body, in a healthy human being, they are known as the resident flora or resident microflora. Whereas microbes that cause disease, they are known as pathogens. Most microorganisms are beneficial, useful to mankind. For example, the alkali gene zootrophus has the capability of making plastics. How cool is that, bacteria making plastics. Pseudomonas is another useful bacterium that can help clean up oil spills. For example, when you have oil spills in the ocean, we can use a species or a strain of Pseudomonas to clean up the oil spills. But please note that not all Pseudomonas species are useful. For example, the Pseudomonas aeruginosa is a pathogen, disease-causing microorganism that causes pneumonia. Many microorganisms are also involved in breaking down the dead and decaying matter, and these are then recycled as nutrients which can be used by other organisms. Antibiotics, many of the antibiotics and other drugs are synthesized by microorganisms, and these antibiotics are mostly produced by the fungi. Lactobacillus or lactobacilli are found in our human gut. They are part of our natural microflora. Many important foods and beverages are made with microbes. For example, the wine, the beer, okay, cheese, yogurt, all these are made with microorganisms. As I mentioned, most microorganisms are useful, but there are a small portion or small percentage of microorganisms that cause diseases. For example, smallpox has been described in ancient Egyptian and Chinese writings and have been responsible for many deaths. In fact, it is claimed that smallpox caused more deaths than all other infectious diseases combined together. There is evidence that malaria and poliomyelitis have existed since ancient times as well. In the 14th century, there was an outbreak of bubonic plague, or known as the Black Death, that killed about 20 million people in Europe alone. Now, in the 14th century, there were no planes or aeroplanes or any fast vehicles for you to move from one place to another, and yet it was able to kill 20 million people in Europe. In the 20th century, the last century, the 1918 influenza killed up to 50 million people worldwide. In this century, more than 30 million people have died of AIDS, and there are still a lot of people dying because of disease-causing microorganisms. So let's take a closer look at a prokaryotic cell, a bacteria. This picture here shows a bacteria. It is easily distinguished from eukaryotic cell because it does not have any nuclear membrane. As you can see here, this is the genetic material, the chromosomal DNA, which does not have a nuclear membrane around it. So this is called the nucleoid region. Prokaryotes, once again, they are unicellular. They only have one cell. And they have simple set of internal structures compared with the eukaryotic cells. Some prokaryotic cells have structures that help them to move from one place to another, and that is the flagella. Bacteria is a prokaryote, as you know, it's a single cell organism. Now, bacteria has cell wall which consists of peptidoglycan. So peptidoglycan is a protein and carbohydrate mixed compound which is found in the cell walls of bacteria. Bacteria reproduce by a process called binary fission. In the next lecture, we will talk about binary fission in more detail. Bacteria, a prokaryotic cell, uses a variety of resources for growth and reproduction. Bacteria also cause infections such as the pneumonia, tonsillitis, tuberculosis, syphilis, Lyme disease, and so on. However, bacterial diseases can be treated with antibiotics. This diagram shows a typical bacterium, okay, which has a cell wall here. So as you can see here, this is a cell wall. Okay, the cell wall gives the cell the shape. It also has a plasma membrane or a cell membrane that regulates the movement of substances in and out of the cell. Then you have the cytoplasm, okay, where all the organelles are found. And then the nucleoid region. Okay, this is the nucleoid region where you have the DNA, the genetic material, which is not surrounded by a nuclear membrane. Next, you have a plasmid. This plasmid is extra chromosomal genetic material. It is also a DNA. We will talk about this in lecture 5. And then you have the ribosomes, which are involved in protein synthesis. They make all the proteins in the cell. And finally, you have the bacterial flagellum, which allows the cell to move from one place to another. As I mentioned in an earlier slide, the cell wall of bacteria contain peptidoglycan. Okay, over here, peptidoglycan. Gram staining is a technique that can be used to differentiate bacteria based on their cell wall constituents. So bacteria that has a thick cell wall, as in this case here, a thick cell wall, they retain the blue dye in the gram stain and they are called gram positive. Whereas bacteria which has a thin peptidoglycan layer retains the red dye in gram stain and therefore it is called gram negative. There are bacteria with no cell wall and those with different materials in their cell wall. But here, when we talk about gram staining, we only refer to bacteria that has peptidoglycan in its cell wall. So this is a brief outline of the gram staining procedure. First, you add crystal violet, which is the blue or purple dye. And then you add a drop of iodine, after which it is washed with alcohol. And then the slide is then washed again with water before applying a secondary stain, which is the safranine. Safranine is red in color. So bacteria that retain the crystal violet, the purple dye, they are gram positive. Because of their thick peptidoglycan, they are able to retain the crystal dye. Gram negative bacteria, because of the thin peptidoglycan, they do not retain the purple dye. However, they take up the counter stain, the secondary dye, the safranine, red dye. Here you see examples of bacteria that are stained and viewed with a microscope. For example, here Staphylococcus aureus appears blue under microscope when stained with gram stain. So this is a gram positive bacteria. Another example will be here Streptococcus pyogenes. This is in chains, as you can see here. The arrangement is in chains. It is blue or purple under gram staining. So this is also a gram positive bacteria. Some bacteria, they form endospores. We will look at the endospores in the next lecture. So how do you know whether the bacteria is capable of forming endospores? We use a spore stain. And then here you have Mycobacterium flavae. This is a bacteria that is difficult to stain with gram stain. So we use acid fast stain to stain this bacteria. It appears pink under the acid fast stain. Gram-negative bacteria, those with thin layer of peptidoglycan in the cell wall, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, so they stain pink. These are gram-negative bacteria. Another example will be the Escherichia coli or E. coli. As you can see, they appear red or pink with gram stain, so they are gram-negative bacteria. Further two examples of gram-positive bacteria here, Clostridium tetani and Bacillus subtilis. We will look at fungi. Bacteria are prokaryotes. However, fungi are eukaryotes. Why? Because they have a distinct nucleus, which means they have a nucleus which has a nuclear membrane surrounding the genetic material. Unlike bacterial cell wall that consists of peptidoglycan, the fungi cell wall consists of chitin. Fungi absorb organic chemicals for energy, for survival, for food. An example of fungi will be the yeast, which are unicellular. If you recall, eukaryotes can be single cell or multicellular. An example of a single cell eukaryote will be the yeast. And fungi also have multicellular organisms such as the molds and mushrooms. The molds consist of mycelia, yeah, and which are composed of filaments called the hyphae. Fungi are the largest and most versatile of all microbes. They are mostly involved in the decomposition process. Okay, they break down decaying matter. And they absorb nutrients from whatever they are growing on. They are unable to make their own food. However, fungi can be very helpful or very beneficial to humans, especially in the food industry. A lot of food products are made with fungi. For example, tofu, tempeh, thosai, all these are made with fungi. In medicine, most antibiotics are made from fungi. Fungi can also be harmful. For example, the mold on bread, the athlete's foot, ringworm, these are diseases caused by fungi. As you can see, fungi, Epidermophyton floccosum, causes athlete's foot. And Candida albicans, another medically very important microorganism, causes vaginal candidiasis and oral thrush. Next, we look at protozoa. Protozoa are also eukaryotes. They ingest organic chemicals as food. They are mobile. Some of them are mobile. They use pseudopods like this, pseudopods, okay, or flagella for movement. They can be free living, as in they can survive independently on their own, or they can also be parasitic, which means they infect a host and derive nutrients from the host. A very important, medically important protozoa will be the Plasmodium species. This is a protozoan that causes malaria. Malaria kills millions of people. Okay. Every year it infects about 1 to 2 million people, and about half of them die due to malaria. Malaria can be caused by any of these species, the falciparum, Plasmodium falciparum, Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium malariae, Plasmodium ovale. So most protozoans are single-celled organisms. As you can see from this picture here, you have here red blood cells. These are all the empty red blood cells. And then those which are infected with malaria are stained purple due to the dye that is used to stain the red blood cells. Plasmodium species is only carried by the anopheles species of mosquitoes, the female ones which feed on blood. Next, we will look at viruses. Viruses, if you recall, are the tiniest of the infectious agents. They are extremely small. And there is a debate as to whether we can consider them as living or non-living. Viruses are unable to produce outside of a host cell. They cannot reproduce outside of a host cell, and they have no metabolic activity. However, when they infect a cell, they are able to take over the cellular machinery and reproduce many copies of their own kind. So some scientists consider them as living because they are able to reproduce once inside the host cell. Viruses contain nucleic acid, either DNA or RNA, not both. And this nucleic acid is surrounded by a protein coat. So it is a very simple structure. You have a protein coat which contains a DNA or RNA. Many diseases are caused by viruses, okay, which are mostly deadly. For example, AIDS, hepatitis, encephalitis, rabies, all these are diseases caused by viruses. The more or less harmful ones will be your influenza, cold, warts, and chickenpox. So this is a diagram of a influenza virus. As you can see, it has a protein coat. Inside the protein coat, you have the RNA, genetic material. Viruses can be with envelope. This is the envelope of the virus, and without an envelope here. As I mentioned, they are inactive outside the host cell, and they are very light because they only contain a protein and a genetic material. As such, they can be carried from place to place by wind, birds, and such. This shows a human immunodeficiency virus. HIV causes AIDS. So you can see from the diagram here, okay, this is a cell, host cell. The virus attaches to the host cell, and then it injects its genetic material into the cell. And the genetic material will then make many, many copies of this HIV virus. Varicella zoster virus causes chickenpox. And after that, later in life, the chickenpox reactivates to become shingles. So when you get chickenpox, the virus, although you are cured of all the rashes and signs and symptoms, the virus stays in the nerve ganglion, and then it reactivates years later and comes again as shingles. Hepatitis, okay, causes infection of the liver. So hepatitis is caused by hepatitis A, B, C, D, and E virus. So they can effectively destroy your liver cells, and then you end up with cirrhosis and even liver cancer. In this lecture, we looked at two main types of cells, the prokaryotic and the eukaryotic cells. We identified the common features. The common features are the plasma membrane or the cell membrane, the cytoplasm, the genetic material, that is the DNA, and ribosomes. We looked at the different classifications, fungi, protista, monera. And we also looked at some of the common microorganisms. We learned about the basics of light microscopy and the use of the light microscope. I hope you have understood the lecture. This is a basic introductory lecture. In the next lecture, we shall look at the microorganisms. What do they need to grow to survive? How they reproduce? And how can we control or destroy them? Thank you.